Hello, it's Jack Tutor here of Attention Magazine. Welcome to Crucial Listening, the podcast where I speak with musicians and sound artists about three albums that are important to them. My guest this time is Dis Fig, which is the project of Felicia Chen. Dis Fig just released a collaborative album with The Body on Thrill Jockey called Orchards of a Futile Heaven. It's really something. The Body are bringing some very overblown, quaking, low-end dense business on this album. And Felicia's presence is just amazing. Sometimes she's deploying a lot of restraint and kind of holding this veneer of composure while everything trembles beneath. Sometimes she's completely letting loose. Often she's managing to carve these kind of pop melodies in the face of these crumbling soundscapes. And I should say as well, she's a DJ. She's released a solo record, Purge, a few years back, and also a collaborative album with The Bug. And on each project, she acts as this effortless hybridizer of different sound worlds. She has this incredible ability to just bring different energies together. Her DJ sets slip seamlessly between styles and maintain this like really formidable momentum. And I think, as illustrated by her three picks for this podcast, she's pulling from a really disparate set of inspirations, and it always sounds unforced. There's this lovely chicaning between musical worlds that's going on with the work of Dis Fig. We had a really nice chat. This was a lot of fun. We went everywhere. I think you'll enjoy it. Thank you for listening, as always. This is episode 150. Think of that. Wow. Thank you. If you've been listening for, hey, only a couple of minutes, because this is your first episode, or longer, I'm very grateful. You can donate to the podcast, if you so please, over at Ko-fi. There's a link in the show notes, ko-fi.com/crucial listening. Any amount you please, one-off, or as a monthly donation. All is welcome. Thank you so much. Here goes then. This is Dis Fig, Felicia Chen on Crucial Listening. Hello, Felicia. Welcome to Crucial Listening.
Hey, what's up?
Hey. Well, good. Thank you so much for coming on the podcast. You're here to talk about three important albums that you've picked. Before we get to those, I would like to talk about your new collaborative album with The Body, Orchards of a Futile Heaven, which is out by the time this comes out on Thrill Jockey. So I understand you made this one remotely, obviously, given your disparate geographic locations. And yeah, we're sending stems back and forth. So my first question is, and you know, this is over a fair period of time, what kind of memories come to mind when you think about what the process of making this record looked like for you? Like, where are you? What kind of times of day were you working on it? Like, what did the sessions look like for you?
You know, honestly, thinking back on when we writing the record, it was, I would say, very broken up in small fragments, because we started it in, I think, the end of 2020 or so, if I can remember correctly. And it took about 3 years to finish. We really worked on it in small, big bursts of energy. So, you know, I would send them some stems. They would send me some stems. Maybe I'd hold on to all of them for months and you know, get to them and go to the studio and maybe spend like, you know, a week or two really intensely on it and then send it back to them, and then they hold on to it for about many more months and do the same thing back and forth. So I don't know, I mean, like that time period, yeah, as we all know, that time period, those years were very kind of like a whirlwind. So it is kind of how I see the writing of this album too. I was definitely in a way different mode than I was in, you know, musically beforehand, like before 2020. I think as everyone else was kind of feeling a little bit more like insular. So that's why I always think that if we had started working on this album before 2020, I think that it would have sounded a lot different. And if we had started working on it now, I think it would have sounded a lot different too. I think that's kind of the reason why I end up sounding a lot more maybe melodic and maybe more intimate than perhaps it would have if we had written it outside of this period of time.
Huh. But,
yeah.
Tell me more about that. What is it about the circumstances that you think drove it more towards like a more melodic terrain?
I think personally for me, because I had just come off of touring for like most of the year of 2019, not being home for a long time. And like my solo show is very intense and aggressive and screaming a lot. I think when I came home and then went through this time period, I was exhausted and tired of screaming.
Right.
So I think that's kind of more why I, yeah, ended up singing more. I missed melodies, I guess.
Which is funny.
And I missed more intimate moments, yeah.
Right. I think when people see the lineup of artists involved here, the reflex is to be like, right, this is going to be cranked, you know, right, on both sides. That's so interesting. I think that's an observation I came away with listening to the record, is the amazing kind of disparity of, you know, this overblown sound and then something that still resembles, not restraint, but, you know, something subdued within it is really interesting.
Yeah. Yeah, this kind of weightful but also weightless floating sensation is kind of how I see it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for sure.
But yeah, I always think that if I were to think of, you know, this big in the body, I would think that it's going to be very noisy. And not that it's not noisy, but, you know, I kind of see these tracks as they're a bit pop.
Right, yeah.
It's just weird, you know, weird to say. However you just define pop, I mean, like, I can even define pop in many different ways, but I it's an album of songs. And these are songs that one could potentially sing along to. So I don't know, that's kind of poppy to me.
Yeah, 100%. I know they're also huge advocates of straight up pop as well in their listening. So.
Yeah, true.
Yeah. What I love is reading interviews with you around your records, and like with Purge, it sounded like, I think you said something about you were kind of relearning your voice, you know, after kind of leaving behind music for a little bit. And then with the record with The Bug, you talked about kind of having to adopt like a very specific mode with that record as well. So it feels like that each collaboration or each project heralds like a reconfiguration or just like an examination of your voice and where you want to take it. So I wonder whether this record, I mean, you've mentioned the fact that obviously being driven towards melodies was like where you were feeling, but I wonder if this record had any kind of similar process going on where you were kind of looking at your voice in that sense.
Yeah, it is interesting. I mean, I do think that all of my projects end up being very different vocally. I don't know if this was specifically a determined choice to do the vocals like this, but I think it was a combination of learning actually how to sing in a more like singer lyrical type of way through my project with The Bug, but also knowing that I wanted to push it still further into like a more chaotic territory. I think it was also, this has to do with one of the albums or one of the records that I chose for this podcast. But in during that time, I was listening back to like some choral stuff, which I think that was very, you know, you definitely hear that coming through on the record. I mean, I grew up a huge choir nerd in school. I think I've said this a bunch of times, so I don't think it's a total secret, but yeah, I was a huge choir nerd in school.
Uh-huh.
And nice. That's also kind of where somehow my early forms of like love and obsession with music came from. And yeah, I think digging back into all of that made me want to put that in this record. Or I mean, it just felt like it made sense too,
mm-hmm.
with the sonics of it and the emotions of it as well.
And I guess entwined with writing melodies or just generally being a vocalist is lyric writing. And it sounds like you've got quite a specific relationship with writing lyrics. How did you find the process of writing lyrics for this one?
I hate writing lyrics. The worst part of the process for me. Okay, the way that my brain works is a bit weird. It's very hard for me to comprehend lyrics when I'm listening to music. My brain just automatically picks up on percussive elements or melodies or whatever type of instrumental elements and like the tone and the melodics of a lyric or like the rhythm of a lyric. Mm. But the actual like words, the linguistics behind it, it just goes into one ear and just like escapes me without me comprehending unless I'm, you know, sitting there really focusing on it. So then the process of writing lyrics is, I think it's a lot harder because maybe I'm not so used to listening to lyrics all the time. And I don't know, I think somehow I feel like I talk a lot, but I'm still not good with words. But yeah, anyway, with lyrics, I learned my process of writing lyrics through writing the Bug album. And it usually starts with a melody and a rhythm. And then I am kind of singing in stream of consciousness, which oftentimes I like to keep,
mm-hmm.
Because I think there is definitely meaning behind it and like magic behind that, the stream of conscious take. But if I'm trying to write lyrics, then I will take that meter or the melodies and kind of understand what it's about through listening to myself already with the first take and then figure it out word by word.
Huh. Yeah.
So from my perspective, it's pretty tedious because it doesn't come supernatural to me, to be honest. But I think through especially the album with the Bug, I really learned how to do it in my own way. So actually for the Body album, I think maybe half of it is with lyrics and half of it is just the original take that I ever made of the vocal.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So, I mean, yeah, I think oftentimes, you know, I'll write the instrumental part and then close my eyes, hit record. I just sing whatever comes out. And then half the times I keep it because I feel like the magic is there and the meaning is there. And for me to replicate it and try to put it in, you know, I don't know, like 50 words would not mean the same thing.
Yeah.
Or would do a disservice to like the full meaning and feeling of what it actually was.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, I think the voice is a strange thing in the sense that, like, if you're playing sax and you come across a particular timbre, which is very specific to how you're pronouncing that note, you stick with it because it sounds good. But then if you find a phonetic accompaniment to a particular note within vocals, then lyrics comes in and you're like, okay, right, well, you know, do I try and replicate that like phonetic moment, but in language, or Like, is there an do you do any of that as well, where you're like, well, okay, that phonetic thing right there felt good, but I'm not saying anything, so I'm gonna almost like lead with the feel of that sound first and find words that kind of fit that vibe?
Is yeah actually when, you know, if I'm deciding to write lyrics for something, then I'll play back what I sang, and then I will type it out, what, like, kind of close to what words it could be.
Oh, cool.
You know, so if I'm saying like E, then, you know, I might type in C or something. And then based on that, then I'll kind of try to readjust it to fit what I'm trying to say.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, I have to change things here or there, or whatever. But the stream of consciousness, I mean, melodic, rhythmically, and also phonetics, that is what dictates what it ends up being. There's been many times where I've tried to, yeah, write lyrics to these stream of consciousness takes, and I do, and then I record them, and they just don't sound as special. Mm-hmm. Because, like, the spirit and the feeling's not there. So
I should say that I think the lyrics really bring it on this album. Like, they completely shape my relationship with the record for the good.
Cool.
Yeah, for sure.
That's very cool to hear.
Yeah, I mean, I'm kind of similar to you. They don't always leap out at me, but there's just some repeat phrases that crop up throughout this album, or repeat themes even, that just feel super coherent in the same kind of zone as the record sonically. So cool. I'm all for it. Whatever you're doing, keep doing it, Felicia. Because
hell yeah,
works for me. Yeah, the record is awesome. It will be out, like I say, by the time that this interview comes out, so I will put a link in the show notes so people definitely check it out. So let's go to your important records now. So one question I like to ask at this point is about how you thought about the term important when picking your list of three records. So was there a way that you understood the word important to come up with the list of three records that you did?
I thought a bit about what the prompt was. And I mean, I could have just given you the most important records to me and to my life and the most meaningful ones. But I thought it would be more interesting to choose the ones that are most important to me and also more most relevant to this record that is coming out with The Body. Each of these, I think, have some kind of connection to either the mood of the record or influences for the record, or
Nice. Okay. Which one would you like to talk about first?
I think you should choose.
Nicely done. Because you mentioned choral work in that first segment, should we go for Arvo Pärt?
Yes.
Would you pronounce it Arvo Pärt as well?
I think so. I mean, I'm going by the German version of the A with the umlaut, so
same,
I think so.
Yeah. Te Deum.
Yeah, so, Te Deum.
Te Deum, nice. So yeah, give me a little introduction as to why this one's important to you.
So Te Deum is like about, like a 45-minute piece by Arvo Pärt. It is a choral work with orchestra as well. I first heard of it maybe 5, 6, 7 years ago via a friend of mine who is a amazing professional choral singer. She just posted it, and I dug right in. And as I said before, choral music is really important to me. I mean, I'm not extremely well-versed in it, but having sang in choirs for like 7 years of my life in the past, maybe more, it is where I really discovered this really special feeling and connection to music and participating in the music making as well. So this specifically is, you know, a religious piece. And I wouldn't say that I am religious. Maybe I might be spiritual. I believe in some things, but definitely not, you know, one, you know, narrow religion. But anyway, I feel that religious music is really powerful. and more so powerful because of the power that it has on people and the power that is it has had on people throughout centuries and centuries. So for me, the power doesn't come from, you know, one almighty God. It comes from the minds and the hearts of the humans that, you know, are having faith. Because human minds are really powerful. Yeah, I don't know. This piece is just gorgeous and haunting and beautiful and really powerful, super dynamic. And oftentimes when I'm listening to it, it brings me to tears because it's so powerful.
Had you listened to much Arvo Pärt before this one?
This was my first introduction to his work. And this launched me into listening to all of his other stuff. I more so like the choral stuff versus like maybe just his piano pieces. But yeah, all of his work is so amazing. I think also something about him that I really like is I love the harmonies and like the dissonances that he lands on. I think he really holds a special place in like religious, I guess you would call it religious music, religious classical music. I'm not sure.
Yeah.
But I think he holds a special place. And I feel like no one tugs at my emotional heartstrings as much as Arvo Pärt does.
Yeah. I think the point you make about a kind of religious nature is really interesting. And also when you weave it into what you said about the dissonances, because I think when I stereotypically think of religious music, my mind immediately thinks that will be something upbeat that's reflecting the light and, you know, it's kind of a very wholesome kind of thing. And yet, when actually I think of people who are conveying religious music, there is dissonance and kind of something that can be borderline unsettling about it. Like, you know, I'm a big Albert Ayler fan, a John Coltrane fan, and, you know, spirituality was right at the center of what they're doing. And yet they were screaming at the top of their lungs. So it's like that religious aspect actually contains so many shades.
Yeah. Because the reality of it is, you know, there's light and darkness.
Mm-hmm.
I think also with Te Deum too, I think that's what makes it so beautiful is that it seems so dark and haunting and eerie and sad and lamentful. But then all of a sudden, like peeking through like these clouds is like this ray of sunlight of these, you know, sopranos singing. It's sick.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm all about dynamic range. So this shit is, yeah.
It's king, yeah.
Sick.
Yeah. Structurally, it's a strange one too, right? I feel like this is a piece that could almost never end. Is that like a part of the appeal of it as well? The way that it's... Because sections kind of come back and reprise and then it dips down, comes back up.
Yeah.
Lose track of time.
Yeah, totally. Yeah, I feel like even just before I was kind of listening back to it so I can kind of remember, you know, why it touched me so much. But I remembered how there's not really, I don't think you could put a label to any like specific movements in it. Of course, there's like certain parts, but yeah, it just all kind of comes together in like a cyclical storm, which I think makes it even better. There's not really any like specific breaks and like, okay, here's the second movement. We're going to be happy now. It's a crazy constellation that is ever evolving and coming back and circling back and throwing its punches.
One of the questions I was going to ask, which I guess isn't applicable given when you discovered it, but was whether you ever sung this work, but I guess you were out of the...
No, but I want to. Oh, that would be a dream. That would really be a dream. No, I haven't. But... I have seen not this particular work by Arvo Pärt, but another one. I forget the name of it, but it was also an amazing choral works. I saw it being performed in a beautiful cathedral, I think Upper East Side in Manhattan, in New York, with like, yeah, full a full choir and like organ. It was amazing. So cool. I think also the parts of the choir were split up, and one was on your right side and your left side. Cause it was also kind of like, I think in this piece, it's kind of like a call and answer type situation. So yeah, being in the center and then like the organ, you know, pipes are behind you, or maybe they're in front of you. Doesn't matter. It's 360.
Yeah. You can always turn around.
Amazing. Yeah.
I mean, that's the thing. I almost find it, when you've got that 360 thing and you've got the religious nature, you're like, am I being converted through
really?
Force?
Yeah, really. What is going on here?
Yeah. Like, I wondered whether, given that you did sing choral work for such a long time, are there any pieces from that period where you were singing which you've maintained a relationship with because of an intimacy gained through singing them?
Yeah, every once in a while I will revisit these choral pieces, and it'll bring the same feeling to me that I had when I was like 16 years old singing it with, you know, this choir around me, or like in absorbed in the choir.
Wow.
One is a piece called Onata Lux by Morten Lauridsen. Yeah, also amazing a cappella, this one was. And yeah, even still, when I put my headphones on and, you know, really soak in, like, it brings me to tears. Yeah. I don't know if choral work would have the same impact on me if I had not spent so much time in choirs and had, you know, had the pleasure of experiencing what it feels to be, you know, a part of this entity that's making this beautiful sounds. I don't know if I would appreciate it less. I mean, I guess I'm thankful for the fact that, you know, I did have this experience. But I think about it a lot, how I would love to rejoin a choir, or even, you know, write some choral pieces in the future in some, you know, obviously like my different kind of way.
Yeah.
But it's definitely something that I still hold very dearly to my heart.
Which I guess is evident on the new record. I mean, even without having this context, there are moments of really like intensely and beautifully overlain voice on this record with the body. So in which ways were you kind of thinking about choral music? I'm sure maybe it wasn't this conscious, but tell me a bit about the connection between like choral music and maybe this Arvo Pärt piece, and, you know, how you were thinking about approaching the vocals on that record.
Well, I think, I don't know if it came first that I was digging back into him, or that I just had the idea to do choral stuff for this album. But I mean, the thing is, actually on my solo record Purge, I also had like a choral track a bit, not in the same way, but still, you know, some few voices and harmonization. But I think because it felt as powerful inside the environment of this record as would be a place of worship, whether it's a, you know, temple or cathedral or whatever. And I think that's why it just felt really appropriate to bring a choral moment in. And also, I mean, because I haven't really written full choral piece yet, maybe this was just a little dip into the waters. Much more to come.
Nice. Let's go to your second important record then. Would you like me to pick this one? Or have you got one that... should we go for Portishead dummy.
Sure.
Love it. Okay, great. This is a good pick. So tell me a little bit about why this one's important to you.
Yeah, Portishead is amazing. I think my favorite band. This record, I don't know what to say about this record. Like, it's amazing, and it really has a huge impact on me and my own work, I guess. Beth Gibbons is, I don't know. Mm. Like, what do I say about her? Yeah. Like, fuck. Beth. Yeah. Yeah, she's amazing. Like, the amount of layers of emotion that she packs into a single peep of her voice is crazy.
Mm.
It's also it's so contained too, and it drips like milk, and yeah, she's amazing. I think she's my favorite vocalist, and this record, I mean, I love all three records. I think Dummy is probably everyone's favorite, but I think that the other ones are just as amazing, and maybe some of them get more snoozed on than Dummy and should get more love. But I guess I chose Dummy because, you know, it's their first statement.
Mm.
And there's really nothing like it. You know, if you want to, you put it in like the trip hop genre or whatever, but like, I still have never heard any trip hop, like, you know, anything trying to be trip hop or trying to be like Portishead. Like, no. Portishead was just different. And yeah, for me, it's less about, you know, these breakbeat sounds or whatever, but, and more about the weight of it. For me, Dummy is just like a really, really fucking heavy album. And heavy doesn't need to be noisy. It doesn't need to be super intense. It's just really weightful and emotional. Like, the bass on this record is crazy.
Yeah.
So I think with Portishead also, I really respect them because all three albums sound super different. I don't think you could put them in the same genre, but the fact is that they all sound like they're from Portishead. And I think with my music as well, I mean, I don't really know what genre to call any of this, to be honest. I've heard ones thrown out and like, cool, but I honestly have no idea what any of this is. But for me, what's central to all my music is the heavy emotionality of it all. And I think that that can translate in many different sonic forms, but the root of it is all heavy emotional. And yeah, I think with Portishead, it's the same thing.
Do you remember how you first discovered it?
I don't actually, because I think, when did this come out? Like 94? 94. Yeah, 94. So I was 5 years old at the time.
Uh-huh.
So, I mean, at that time I was watching MTV with my sister. She was older than me. So I was just, you know, watching everything that she watched and absorbing music that way. And I'm sure that I listened to Portishead when, you know, I was 5 years old watching the TV, but I can't remember it specifically. I think that it took me a while to get back into really deep diving into them. That happened when I was in university, like 2008 or something. So quite a while after these albums came out. Actually, I do remember, I remember the instant that I got back to Portishead because I was in my friend's room and I was super, super stoned. And someone put on Wandering Star and I was like, oh, fuck. I was like, oh, shit, what is this? And yeah, that got me deep diving fully for the first time into the Portishead, like, full world. But I think also at the time I was listening to a lot of like just bass heavy music. So I think the connection between that and Portishead with their like concentration on low end was probably what drew me more into them at that time.
I'm so glad you brought up the low end emphasis on this record, because I'd totally forgotten about it. And it's crazy. I was driving to this record and I was like, what is happening to my car?
Yeah. Even I think the first, like the first tone of Mysterions, I think that's the first song.
Yes.
Even that is just like, okay, that's what this is going to be about. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, this is it. And like, it's kind of produced like a dub record where it's got a lot of space in the middle, which I guess is kind of like Beth's sort of crevice where she can exist. But a lot of the instruments, and this kind of ties into the sort of like tinny gramophone timbre of a lot of the top end, but a lot of the instruments other than the bass and Beth are very much in the upper range, which again, I'd forgotten that they'd left the middle so wide open. But yeah, it feels very dub-like.
Yeah. I mean, it makes sense.
Yeah, yeah. Have you seen them live?
No. I want to. I would love to. I don't know. Like, when is that going to happen again? I think we need to put a petition or something. Well, actually, Beth just, she just released a first single for a new album. Did you see that?
Have you heard it?
I have heard it.
What do you think?
I think it's good. I want to hear more.
Yeah.
I mean, I think she can do no wrong, so I'm going to listen to it and probably love it anyway. Definitely a different vibe than Portishead, of course. But yeah, I mean, I love her, so I'm a stan, so I'm definitely going to listen to it.
I agree, though, because it's like, it feels like potentially one flavor of what could be a multifaceted record. And I think, like you, like I want to hear what warrants this being a solo record rather than a Portishead record. Like, what happens when you strip away, you know, the Portishead from Beth? Like, where does she want to go?
Right.
And that's going to become apparent. But holy moly, like, her voice, you know, obviously I've been listening to Dummy and prep for this, and then hearing that new single come out, she is so consistent.
I know, so on point. Like, yeah, decades later, still on point.
Still bringing it. It's just the pitch control is like...
Does she smoke? I always ask this, like, does she smoke?
Do you think that could be the secret?
No, I ask this because, I mean, my parents won't listen to this, but sometimes I smoke. And I'm trying to look for excuses to really stop, but also kind of looking for people also maybe secretly that do smoke and trying to figure out the way that they maintain while maintaining the really bad habit.
Oh, nice. So like, how can you have your cake and eat it? I like that.
Yeah. I'm just, you know, just taking surveys, trying to figure out, you know, what's going on with these vocalists that seem to be untouchable because, you know, I want that.
yeah. Beth definitely just seems, there's just a complete effortless sounds is entirely wrong, but she has just something going on, which is just, it sounds corny, but like a gift. So I reckon she could smoke whatever she likes.
Yes, I think so too.
She'd be completely untouched somehow. Such as, you know, the gifts of the divine. But
her voice is so controlled, but when you think it's not like it's emotionally controlled because it feels so free, but the tonality feels like it just feels like she has a lot of control over it.
Yes.
Not that it's like controlled in a box or anything, but that she has full control over her voice.
Yes. Yeah. And it reminds me a bit, because obviously she brings this very precarious vibrato to her voice as well, and it's like riding a bike slowly where she still avoids falling somehow.
Yeah, good analogy. Yeah.
Do you have a favorite song on Dummy?
I don't think so. I can't. Wait, let me look at the track list real quick if one sticks out. Do you hear me playing them?
No, I don't.
Okay, it's just in my headphones. No, man, I can't choose. They're all fucking brilliant. I can't.
Yeah. It's funny, like Wandering Star sticks out for me. It sounds like maybe, you know, because that was your gateway back in.
Right.
But for me, that was the first song I heard on this record. So that one juts out. Was it a single? I think it was, but there were maybe other bigger singles, weren't there?
Yeah, I think so. I think Rose was a really big single, right?
I think so.
Or Glory
Sour
Box.
Times, maybe? Yeah, Glory Box as well, yeah.
We just named like all the tracks.
I think you're right.
So like, were you super into them in 94 when they first came out?
Oh no, I was, I think we're a similar age, so I was 4 years old. But then I think in the mid 2000s when I was on forums and stuff and people were kicking up sort of weirder stuff, then people like, you know, a few people said to me, you should check out Porter's Head. But interestingly, as you say, like, no other trip hop really came up in those recommendations, and I think Porter's Head had something which, as you know, they were lumped in with that category, but just it's an odd fit.
I guess it's, you know, where they're from in that particular movement at that time, but they're just different. I think they're I always ask, maybe we can decide to cut this out of the podcast later.
Okay.
But I always, you know, there's always the debate, Portishead or Massive Attack?
For me, Portishead, because, plainly, because Portishead released third. And I just think that is such an incredible turn for a band who was making that kind of music in the 90s and then made a record like third. Like, it wasn't out of reach, but when it came out, I just remember being like so floored by that album. What is your answer to that question?
I'm definitely Portishead. I also love Massive Attack, and they have some amazing records and amazing songs, but I think Portishead, there's no track by Portishead that's a snoozer.
Uh-huh.
They release nothing that I'm like, meh.
Mm-hmm.
But I think Massive Attack had, there's a few, you know, I skip.
Yeah.
Quite a few that I skip.
Do you think Portishead have kind of an advantage for only having like three full lengths to their name? Like they...
For sure. But also at the same time, then you really know that they really put a lot of intention behind everything, which I respect.
Totally. Yeah.
Like... Yeah, I mean, of course I would love a new Portishead album. I think we all would, but I'm not so mad at the fact that we're not getting one.
Yes.
Or that we haven't got one yet, because I'm so thankful that we have these. And I'd rather, they put out things that they really put their heart into and really, you know, put all their intentions into than just releasing stuff to release it.
Yeah,
just to release stuff because they made it. You know what I mean? Not saying that Massive Attack did that by any means, but just saying.
No, for sure. Which does put a little bit of pressure on this new Beth solo record, because it's you know, it is the first new omission from. Well, she's done other stuff, right? But
true.
Yeah,
I wonder how she feels. We should have Beth on.
I'll see if I can get her cut. How Beth feels about releasing a new album?
Yeah, just because it's been a long time.
Yeah, yeah.
And I just wonder, you know, has she been thinking about this a long time? Because before she made this announcement, I always think, what's Beth doing right now? You know, she's just chilling at home. Is she riding off like whatever, like licensing money or whatever from the Portishead albums? Like, what is Beth doing? Where does she live? Does she have a family? I don't know.
Well, isn't this the crazy thing about relating to people exclusively as musicians? Especially when they made such powerful music. There's a part of me which is always like, where's, like, you've made all this incredibly powerful music. You can't just go back to your family or other parts of your life that need you. Like, but obviously, you know, that completely neglects the multifaceted nature of just being a human being outside of an artist. But you were just kind of like, oh my gosh, why don't you just, you know, hunker down and pop a new Portishead record out?
I can understand it though. I can understand also being just fucking tired.
Yeah, for sure.
You know, and wanting to focus on relationships with yourself and others, you know?
Yes. Yeah.
But yeah, I guess now we know what she was doing, at least for the past year or so. Always feel this way, and the time that I was sufferless is when I never have to wake. Wandering stars, for whom it is reserved, the blackness, the darkness forever. Wandering stars.
So the final album, I will continue the trend of announcing it at this point, goth-trad, Psyonix. Give me an introduction as to why this one's important to you.
I chose this one not specifically for the importance of this album in particular, but more just the importance of goth-trad. And I felt like this album was a good, I guess, example of... what he's doing and what he's like reaching into and stuff. Yeah, goth-trad is sick. For anyone who doesn't know him, he is a Japanese producer who many years ago was releasing on Deep Medi and kind of broke out into like the UK scene of UK dubstep through that. And he continues to like run his own shit in Japan. And so actually the reason why goth-trad is important to me and to this record is because I think about, I don't know, maybe 8 years ago or something, he put out a mix. I think it's on two separate mixes that I listened to where he's mixing some of his own productions and other people's productions. And he drops a track by The Body. Yeah. And I didn't know about The Body at that time, or maybe someone had told me to check them out, but I hadn't really like dove into them. So when I heard that track, yeah, I obviously was like, what the fuck is this? I need to know more about this. Like, there's music like this. This is what I want. This is what I've been looking for. Cause for me, I've always, you know, I'm definitely not a metalhead. I don't really know shit about metal. But I have always been kind of like on the outskirts, kind of looking in, peering in, appreciating the energy of the world of metal, and the intensity of it, but not always being super taken by, you know, a lot of the music. I think that actually oftentimes I want something even more heavy than metal. Which might be crazy to say, but yeah, when I heard The Body, that's what they gave. So yeah, thank you to goth-trad for introducing me really to The Body.
That is very cool.
Yeah.
It's a really interesting pick with that in mind, because Psyonix closes with that collaboration with Boris.
Boris, yeah, dead song.
Oh my gosh.
So sick.
Yeah.
So good.
Yeah, which feels like when you talk about wanting something heavier, I feel like that's...
That's it.
That's the one, yeah. It's like that hybridization that you would maybe want, where you're just like, well, what else can we do just to fortify this? It feels like it enacts that very well.
You know, because the heaviness that I'm speaking of is, you know, like the face that you make when you're listening to some filthy metal is the same face as the bass face when you're listening to some filthy deep dubstep.
Yeah.
UK dubstep, okay?
Yeah.
Making that distinction.
UK dubstep. Tell me about that. So I understand that. Is that a big one for you as well, right?
Yeah. For me, it was kind of how I came up into getting into electronic music.
Right.
I mean, I didn't get it into UK dubstep until pretty late, but I think there was kind of like a maybe, I don't know if you want to call it like a renaissance or like a coming back of, not that it died in between, but yeah, like a coming back of UK dubstep in the States, particularly in New York where I was in 2010. Mm-hmm. And yeah, I would go to just a lot of club nights, like bass heavy club nights. And my friend, shout out to Ponch. My friend Ponch showed me Mala for the first time. I think I was like listening to Lean Forward or something. And I'd never heard anything like that before. And yeah, that launched me into like catapulting into this world and like into like really obsessing over low end. And then also at that time, these parties called Reconstruct started happening in New York, where they would bring in like, you know, their own rig and book artists from the UK, but from all over doing this like low end, more UK dubstep kind of sound. That's what got me into going out to clubs and like getting really into, yeah, going to see music with a really fat sub and sound system.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And also led me actually into DJing, which also led me into wanting to make music, which led me into moving to Berlin, which led me into writing my new my first album. So yeah, I think that was a big source of like my trajectory.
That's very cool. I mean, just to touch on your like starting out as a DJ, was it like when you heard this stuff or really started to get into clubbing, what was the jump between that and being like, I want to be a DJ? Like, what was that like link? Were you just like,
honestly, I never thought I was going to be a DJ. I when I was going to, yeah, these shows, these clubs, I was always just going as a fan, like just wanting to hear fucking sick music. Some friends had started DJing and were like producing music and stuff too, but like I never really thought about it myself. Actually, even at that time, I always wanted to write my own music. So that was kind of more of a priority than DJing. And I think, yeah, the friend that I mentioned before, Ponch, he was the one that was like, hey, you should start DJing. Like, you should learn. And then he just gave me his old, like, it was like a Vestax old VCI controller that had like arcade buttons on it instead of like the cue and play and pause buttons had been hacked with like arcade buttons.
Wow.
Pretty sick.
Yeah.
I wonder who has it actually now, because we were kind of passing it along to folks who want to learn. But he just suggested it. I didn't even understand the concept of DJing. I remember listening to a mix one time and it was like, I think he sent me a mix that he had made, and I was, you know, I was asking like, but how did you put the drums on top of the bass? Like, did you cut them up? Like, how did you do that? I was so clueless. But yeah, I mean, he lent me the controller, and I think I just watched YouTube tutorials, and I was like, okay, this is how you do it. And then I made some mixes, and then eventually someone was like, hey, do you want to play at this thing? And it just took off from there, I guess.
Wow, that is so cool. But also, like, it's a brazen thing for a friend to do, to be like, I think you should spend your time doing this activity. But obviously, in retrospect, it's like, you know, very astute, but
I'm so thankful to him. Every time I see him too, he's living in DC, so every time I see him, we always share a moment of like, damn, that's crazy, you know.
that's cool.
Crazy. And like, what, 10 almost 15 years later or something, that's crazy.
Yeah So it sounds like, so goth-trad put you onto the body. There is a few tie-ins that we've touched on where goth-trad also clearly has like an interest in this sort of like metal dub hybrid. Were there any other reasons that like this is the record that you hauled out to talk about?
I think that I think because of what you just said, that it is this crazy crossover between dubstep and metal, which I think people probably don't think about very often, but the energy I think is the same.
Yeah.
I I mean, also, he did a project with, I forget like what the vocalist name is, but it's called Ear Taker.
Uh-huh.
So it's yeah, kind of metal project, but also run by goth-trad's electronics. I mean, I always liked his stuff, you know, in the full realm of like this world of like DMZ, deep medi, dubstep. I always really loved goth-trad for how noisy he was.
Mm-hmm.
Because for me, that's what attracts me to metal too, like the noise aspect of it. I guess I wish for there to be more crossover like this.
Mm.
And I hope that maybe also through this record, you know, some people who might be fans of the body but have no idea about what I do or like the electronic world might be a little bit more interested, and also vice versa.
For sure.
Yeah, but I think, yeah, goth-trad is just, it's special for that, because I think it is not super unique, but still pretty unique for there to be someone standing kind of in the middle of these two circles.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
The center of the Venn diagram.
Yes, absolutely.
There's some of us, but not that many.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, it's interesting as well. Obviously, you know, you've collaborated with Kevin Martin, and there's, you know, a lot of that going on in like Kevin and, you know, his
projects. They're fans of each other too. Yeah, right, exactly.
Yeah.
But I was just going to say, like, the body and the bug. It's funny, like, the similarities in names, but they're also fans of each other.
Oh, cool. Oh, I look forward to that collab record too, then.
Yeah, right? Got to make it happen.
I mean, also as well, so Psyonix, I listened through it a couple of times. It's masterfully, like, constructed stuff as well. Like, the first track is just like a... hey, watch me build this piece of music bit by bit. And almost, you know, I'm not saying this is necessarily precisely what it is, but like, look how my brain ticks in terms of what feels appropriate to bung on here. And it's got this very strange, like, downbeat teasing thing where you're kind of like not really sure where the rhythm falls until like another layer comes in and it all clicks. It's
finding the groove.
Kiss. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Beautiful.
Finding the groove slowly and slowly, kind of teasing it in.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
So do you think there's like, are there any other, because I guess you experienced like UK dubstep and dub more than a live context, which are there any records though that like, if it wasn't this one you were going to pick to kind of like illustrate that crossover or your love for like big bass, that would be another one that you would maybe like bring to the selection too?
You mean like the crossover between like big bass music and more like noisy, metally type of stuff?
Yeah.
Ooh. Hold on. Let me think for a second.
I mean, again, it's a mean question because it's like, you know, you spent a lot of time thinking about these three records. Like, how about the fourth?
Yeah. What the fuck? Do you mean big bass, like specifically UK dubstep kind of?
It was a very imprecise question, to be honest, Felicia. It was, I've given you the work of like not only finding an answer but figuring out what the fuck my question was. It's a good question. Like, I think as I was articulating, you know, it, I was like, yeah, go for it.
Okay, I will say, not in the specific way, but I think there are other people that are in this little soup of this like crossover of the Venn diagram.
Uh-huh.
And I think of people like Prison Religion.
Okay, yeah.
And I think of people like Slickback.
Yeah. Oh, okay, yeah. Nice.
And like of Duma, like Dream Crusher even.
Well, do you know what's funny? It's like I saw Duma live at Primavera Sound, and then immediately afterwards went out and Playboi Carti was playing and had like a metal guitarist on stage
Hell
with them
yeah.
too.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Yeah.
So I was like, huh.
That's happening too, for sure.
Yeah.
For sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. I think that maybe today and hopefully more today and tomorrow, like I think people aren't so purist with genres, you know?
Yeah, for sure.
And I think that they shouldn't be because that's what makes genres so boring.
I mean, because it feels, there's an absurdity to it, right? Where it's like, right, we want to make the heaviest music. We're a rock band. We want to make the heaviest music we can. And someone, being like, let's bring a bit of dub to it. And people being like, shut up. We don't do that here.
I don't really, I mean, with all genres, I don't understand like sticking to the same formula over and over again. Like, what's the point? Like, people have done it already. Like, we have those things. Why can't we make something new?
Yeah.
That's what music is for.
For sure.
Creating new things that we can listen to and, you know, experience.
Which is actually why I really love the trajectory of your DJ sets as well, because they don't stick in one place for too long at all, and you're
No,
like, whoa.
I could get bored. I get bored. Like, I don't want to listen to this beat again. Like, let's do something else and let's do the combination of that and see what weird, freaky thing happens there.
Right.
And I also, you know, like I also really love because I think my DJ sets, because it's so diverse, it belongs. I mean, it ends up being in such a diverse breadth of spaces.
Yes.
So I love the fact of being in, like, I don't know, like a techno world that night and maybe playing some techno for them, but then dropping some like Memphis rap on top and being like, yeah, you're gonna fucking dance to this. And it works, you know? And the exact opposite way, if I'm like at like more of like a hip hop party, I'll do the same and put techno on top and be like, see? Or put dubstep on top and like, see, you like this music too.
Felicia, I have one more question for you, which relates to how you bring music into your life, how you listen to it, basically what being a music listener looks like to you. So are there places you go specifically to buy music? Are there formats you prefer? Where do you do your music listening? Let me into a little bit of that.
I think it's getting more and more challenging to consume music today. And I don't know what's to blame. I mean, maybe it's just the fact that we have so much access on so many different platforms and so many different like devices that it gets really confusing for me personally to know what is my route. I mean, I grew up, you know, obviously on cassettes and CDs and, you know, having them in cars and really spending time with these albums and really like growing this relationship with them. And I really miss that. And then that also, you know, that evolved to, you know, I grew up on Napster. So, and Napster and what, LimeWire and all that stuff. So, you know, obviously illegally downloading, but building like a whole library in my computer that then I would transfer onto my iPod and then spend all this time with these albums. And now I'm actually really confused because I get some stuff off Bandcamp, then, you know, friends are sending me some stuff on YouTube, and then maybe like a trickle of like SoundCloud. And then, you know, if I'm trying to look something up and, you know, trying to remember this album from this one artist or wanting to save an album from an artist so that I can listen to it later, then I'm on Spotify, even though fuck Spotify. And so now it's like all of my music is in so many different places. I still have my computer library for sure, but the fact that everything's on different places, and the way that we're consuming it is less, it's so fast paced that like usually you hear about new stuff on Instagram and then you can't click on, you can barely click on the link.
Yeah.
Or save things, you know. I mean, I have like a folder of saved music on Instagram, but like I don't check it.
No, right.
That's my bad, but you know. And I'm not blaming, I guess I'm really just blaming myself for all of this.
Not well, but it's a really good point, because I think what you've highlighted with sort of the initial abundance of digital music was at least it's still all converged upon a single playing device.
Now that's
been atomized, and that is, I find that difficult too. If I'm just going to sit and decide what record to listen to, I've got to flick through like four different places, and it feels like the medium has too much influence on what you choose. Sure.
And I just get confused, so it's pretty tedious to keep up with listening to music, which is also why I think in the past I think during the pandemic I lost the routine of listening to music, and then I lost the process. I think also my headphones broke, and I forgot that I listened to music in headphones, right. And I didn't replace them. And then I started listening to music off my phone, which is like the biggest crime in the world. And I was committing it every day, and it made me actually not be able to listen to any other music besides like radio friendly, like 2000s R&B.
For someone who's gone off about 15-20 minutes about low bass, to hear that was your main means of listening is quite distressing.
I know, man. It was sad. I love Ashanti and I love all that.
Nice.
But yeah, it was sad to not be just listening to music how I would normally listen to music, and like exploring new music and stuff. But now I will say that I have kind of gotten over that hump and been a lot more intentional about sitting down and listening to records. And yeah, so for me now, sadly, Spotify is definitely one of those sources that, although I'm definitely not endorsing Spotify, fuck Spotify. A user sometimes out of convenience. But yeah, definitely Bandcamp for sure, because I think for now at least that's the closest that we have to, no, I'll just say that it's like the highest ranking right now out of like the platforms that we have to use. But I still work on my library that is now living on like my 1 terabyte USB stick that I've backed up twice, because we never want to lose it. I mean, I recently went back and found some old hard drives from like a little bit from when I was a teenager, and like from when just a little bit that like I had maybe ripped from some like old MP3 CDs and stuff. So I put that all on the stick. So this is like my treasure chest right now. You know, continually working on that. But it's coming back. I got new headphones.
Happy ending.
They're Bluetooth. They're good. I'm always walking around with them. So it's coming back.
Love it. Just very quickly, that all the stuff from your teen years, has that put you down a rabbit hole with stuff you used to listen to?
Yes. Yes.
Which artists are we talking about? You don't have to divulge if you don't want to, but I'm very interested.
I think I'm gonna say that for another podcast.
Love it. That's great. Love it.
Y'all have to wait for that information.
Oh, beautifully done. Okay, Felicia, thank you so much.
When I'm ready to embarrass myself even more. But it is.
Amazing. Thank you. This has been great. I love the three records you picked. Like I say, the new collab with The Body is awesome. People do go check it out. Appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you so much for having me. It was a pleasure.
To everyone listening, see you next time. Goodbye.
Goodbye.